amigas. I'm Norma, your host here at the Latinas and Libros Book Club. And I'm so excited to welcome you to our very last Latinos and Libros Book Club chat series for 2023. It's been an incredible year filled with amazing books and soulful conversations with amazing writers. This month, we're closing out with a bang. And we're going to be chatting all about creep with Myriam Gurba, who shares personal essays that also serve as cultural critiques. She examines the way in which oppression collectively enacts and is sustained by ecosystems, unfairly distributing suffering to some of our most vulnerable community members. Braiding her own history and identity throughout, she argues for a new way of conceptualizing oppression, and she does it with her signature blend of bravado, humility, and levity. Amigas, please join me in welcoming Myriam Gurba.
Hi, thank you so much for inviting me to participate in this book club. I really, really appreciate it. I'm excited about our conversation.
Thank you for being here, Myriam. We're so excited to have you back. It's been an eventful year for you. I know you're just sort of on the heels of finishing your tour. Thank you for making the time to join us. I'd like to take a minute before we start to say, to also thank Avid Reader Press and Simon Schuster for sponsoring this event. We are so, so happy that we're here today. So let's dive right in, Myriam. Let's pick up where we left off. Okay. So for those amigas who haven't had a chance to read the book yet, will you tell us a little bit more about your essays, your collection, and why you decided to write it?
Sure. So the collection is titled Creep, because that word played an instrumental role in freeing me from domestic violence. So the collection culminates in the 11th essay, which is the title essay. I placed it strategically at the end, and it chronicles my experience of domestic violence. And what I did was trace its trajectory from meeting my perpetrator, becoming entrapped by my perpetrator, and then escaping from my perpetrator. And the night that I escaped from him was a night that took about a month's worth of planning in order to set the stage for me to be able to flee. And when it happened, I had coordinated with a friend so that I could stay at his house. And this friend protected me and prevented my abuser from being able to chase me indoors, because he was trying to do that. And at first, the friend who was protecting me was trying to be really diplomatic with my abuser. But eventually he got really frustrated, and he yelled at my abuser. He called him a creep. He said, "Get the fuck out of here. You're a creep." And I had not heard anybody talk to my abuser that way, because nobody had seen my abuser with his mask off. But this evening, my friend actually witnessed how my abuser truly behaves. He was trying to, you know, enter his home. And right. So that word, hearing him called a creep, sort of like unmasked him, and he was named appropriately. And so that word became like a key for me, and almost like a torch for me. And I sort of like latched onto that word like a talisman, or like an amulet, if a word can be an amulet or a torch. And I used it to guide my way in the crafting of these other essays.
Oh, that's so profound. Myriam, I don't think I knew that part of the story. Thank you so much for sharing. It's a wonderful reminder of how powerful words can be and our story. So as you were mentioning, your memoir unfolds in 11 essays that are extremely insightful, powerful, concise, and incredibly vulnerable. Can you tell us a little bit more? And you sort of touched on this, but I'd like to see if you could go a little bit deeper about the structure of the book, how you decided to organize the essays, and how the, because Amigas, I want you to understand that the essays touch on so many different topics relating to creeps of all kinds. Big creeps, little creeps, systems, individuals, you know? So can you tell us a little bit more about how the essays relate to each other and why and how you organized them in the way that you did?
So the title essay Creep was placed at the end for a very strategic reason. It's a really difficult essay because it's very graphic and very violent. And
also very beautiful.
Thank you.
It's also very, very beautiful.
Thank you. I worried that had I placed that essay at the beginning of the collection, it would have cast such a long shadow across all of the other pieces. And so what I wanted for the reader to experience was the process of getting to know me, the process of getting to know the world that I inhabit, and the process of getting to know the cultures that created me. And then once the reader is familiar with that, I drop the reader into what I refer to as the fog. And it's the fog that that consumes a person when that person is being coerced, when that person is being tricked, when that person is being fed illusions. And so I wanted for the reader to develop some intimacy with my world before I brought them into sort of the most intimate situations of all that are disclosed in that final essay.
The way in which you lead the reader from essay to essay really is so beautifully executed. And yes, the title essay is difficult in some ways. It also presents a topic that touches so many of us in such a sort of exploratory and really, like, I don't mince words when I say it's a beautiful essay, because you manage to weave in your gift with words really manages to pull the reader in and experience some of the fear that you've experienced, some of the ups and downs that you specifically went through. But I'm getting ahead of myself. I have so many other questions that I want to ask you in addition to really diving into that essay. Okay, let's start at the beginning so we can take the reader, because literally I wanted to close with a conversation about Creep, the essay. And I don't want our amigas to miss out on all of the other, I feel like we could literally dissect that essay for an hour plus hours. So let's have the amigas know a little bit more about the work. Okay, so starting at the beginning, let's talk about your essay titled Tell. This essay delves into domestic violence, death, and lack of perpetrator accountability. Someone else's experience, okay? So can you tell us a little bit more about this work and why you decided to kick off the collection with that particular piece?
So Tell introduces all of the themes that are going to be pertinent throughout the book and that are going to reach their apotheosis in the final essay. And the title Tell functions in two different ways. It's an announcement that the book is a project of truth telling. So I'm functioning as a teller, and in some senses almost like a tattletale, because I'm telling on men who have committed these atrocious acts, and men who would much rather have these acts hidden, as I reveal later on in the essay. So I'm loudly telling history. At the same time, Tell functions as a reference to one of the domestic violence killings that takes place in the essay. And that is a femicide that took place in Mexico City that was perpetrated by a visiting gringo writer, William Burroughs, who notoriously murdered his wife And the Burroughs legend came to be that he was attempting to demonstrate his marksmanship to two men, one of whom was his lover, and invited his wife to put a glass on her head. And he took out his pistol and he aimed for the glass. And he realized what he had, Burroughs realized what he had done when he noticed that there was a small hole in his wife's forehead and she fell to the ground. And her body remained in Mexico. She was not a Mexican. She was from New York. She was a white woman from New York. But in sort of the ultimate act of control, her remains never made it home. So I begin the collection as an homage to her, and I attempt to return some of her humanity, some of Joan Vollmer's humanity to her, because she's so long been eclipsed by the Burroughs legend, but she was an artist in her own right. And so I attempt to give sort of like a mini biography of her embedded within that essay.
It's such a powerful essay. I mean, your work really is also very much rooted in history. So amigas, if you're thinking, how does this relate to what's happening in the world? Understand that Myriam's work really grounds a lot of your work is really grounded in history. It yes. feels like you are pulling, and I'd love for you to share a little bit with us about some of the research and some of the sort of the process that you undertake to write some of these pieces, because many of them, you know, whether you're talking about nationally sponsored delousing programs, whether you're talking about this incident, you know, whether you're talking about incarceration, you really, really do such a gorgeous job of the pieces are very well researched, and the way that you incorporate this history, this understanding, which so often is forgotten, is it's kind of mesmerizing, because I felt I was getting a history lesson, but also couldn't put the book down because I was just like, no, did that just happen? And If you're not familiar with Myriam's work, she also has this way of making you cackle and making you be like, oh, no, she didn't just say that. No, that didn't just happen. Can you tell us a little bit more about the way and about like your research practice and how you weave history into some of these essays?
Yeah. So I enjoy research. Like, I will do research in my spare time. I will do recreational research. So research doesn't feel like a chore to me. Research is like a joyful pastime for me. So it doesn't feel laborious to do it at all. And I'll give several examples of some of the research that I did for Creep. So The essay tell that we were just speaking about has various Mexican newspaper references. So I dug through Mexican newspapers, both like I guess what you could call mainstream press, but also tabloid papers. So I spent quite a bit of time looking through that those types of publications. I have an essay on my grandfather. And I actually solicited the help of an historian who specializes in the region. He's in England. And so we Zoomed several times so that I could learn about the region. And he shared like archival documents with me from the Archdiocese in Guadalajara. When I wrote my essay on my cousin Desiree and her experience of criminalization as a young Chicana, I interviewed her. So I did hours and hours of interview with her in order to create the essay. I also visited sites where she was incarcerated when I could. Like I visited one of the juvenile halls that she was sent to in order to get a sense of place. So I also visited places. When I wrote about Richard Ramirez, I visited the graves of some of his victims. So I not only did archival research, I did geographic research by placing myself in the context that I was writing about.
And I think that it's that layer of commitment to the story and to the work that really makes this book shine. Because as a reader, you bring us so much depth. It's so incredibly interesting, and you bring so many layers to the essays that a reader can't. It's hard to put it down.
I like my essays thick. Like I want to dense with a lot of material. I want it to be like tres leches, where you're just like, you know, it's so rich. You know what I mean? Like yes. I want that experience for the reader where it's like every bite you have to consume slowly because there's so much happening in every bite, you know?
Yes. And that is exactly the experience that I had. I was just like, oh, there's so much here. Okay. So you just started to touch about this, but I wanted to ask you about Locas, which is one of the essays where you expertly weave your cousin Desiree's story into this larger landscape of violence, female incarceration, and California's long systemic history, and their sort of practice of negligently incarcerating Mexicans. Can you please tell us, so you started to touch on it, I would love if you could tell us a little bit more about that essay, and also if you can share with us the message of hope that your cousin leaves the reader with at the end.
Thank you. I'm very satisfied with that essay. And it's the essay that I think I'm probably the proudest of that's in that collection. It's also the only essay that was commissioned by a family member. So my prima reached out to me and expressed to me that she was very bothered by how she existed in the criminal legal archive of the state of California. That the criminal legal archive reduces her to felon, and crime reporters have also written about her, and none of these crime reporters have ever interviewed her. They've only transcribed what the police have told them about her.
That's so fascinating.
Yeah.
Talk about like who owns your story, who tells your story, exactly, which is also exactly a theme that, you know, runs through so many of your essays, the importance of us telling our own stories. Okay, cuéntanos más.
So what she said to me was, what Desi said to me was that she was very bothered by how she exists on these particular pages. And she wanted the opportunity to explain how it was that she became a quote unquote criminal. And what she kept stressing to me was that female gangsters are not born, female gangsters are made. And what she wants to do is express to whoever will listen how that process occurs socially. So what are the steps? And so she told me that because I've been a witness to her life's trajectory, and I was a witness to that transformation in a very sort of emotionally intimate way, she entrusted me with telling the story. And as kids, when we were about 12, 13 years old, we founded our own gang. It was a two-girl gang called Bocas Pero Locas, PPL, right? And we never disbanded the gang. So I never got jumped out, right? So, when my prima hit me up and asked me to do this, I thought to myself, I'm still in PPL. Like,
yeah, I'm down. Let's do this.
Yeah, I have to do this, right? Because like, you know, when we were kids, we would practice. She taught me like hood penmanship, right? So I feel like here I am still practicing my hood penmanship.
You know? I love it. It's like the updated version. It's the 2022, 2023 version of it.
Totally. So that was the genesis of the essay. Yeah.
Okay. So can you tell us a little bit more? So as I talked about briefly, one of the themes that you weave through the entire book really is the importance of storytelling. So can you tell us in Locas, can you give us a little bit about the message of hope that your cousin
absolutely
wants to convey?
So what my cousin wants for readers to understand is that childhood experiences of severe trauma were what set her on the path to criminalization. Ultimately, what she was looking for was safety, and she believed that she was going to find it in a gang family because they promised to always have her back. And as a child at age six, when my cousin disclosed to immediate family that she was experiencing sexual abuse, she was told to be quiet and to not slur her family because we don't talk about our family that way. And so, absolutely heartbreaking. And so she had this incredible hunger for safety. And the safety came from gangsters. That was where she found it. And so she was ultimately looking for family. And it's a little corny to mention it, but she describes how she began the cycle of running away from home and then was taken in East Los Angeles by a specific gang. And she recalls one of the first nights that she stayed the night at their home and slept on the couch, and they fed her homemade caldo de pollo, homemade chicken soup. And I mean, it was literally chicken soup for the homie soul. You know what I mean? Like, that's what she found in East Los Angeles. So once she became criminalized, that set her on the path toward prison. And the criminalization began when she was 14 years old. She was stopped by a gang unit and arrested. And so that set her on the path toward prison. And prison and jail became sort of like revolving doors for her. And she had developed an addiction. She was a drug addict. And there was a judge working in Los Angeles some time ago, like a decade ago, who was running a program called the Second Chance Program. And he identified that many of the women who were coming through his courtroom were survivors of extreme violence, and most of it was gender-based. And that rather than punish the women who were coming into his courtroom, he was going to offer therapeutic treatment to the women so that they could recover and that they could heal. And so this judge gave my cousin several opportunities, and she was able to complete the program and have her record expunged. And interestingly, the judge who operated this program, his name is Judge Tynan, he's mentioned earlier in the book. He's the same judge that oversaw the Night Stalker trial. So my prima told me that when she would be in the courtroom as part of the Second Chance program, you could see the chair that the Night Stalker had sat in as a defendant. They had not removed the chair. And that sometimes if Judge Tynan would get pissed at somebody, he'd be like, don't make you sit in the Ramirez chair. So they had it in the courtroom. And I asked my prima, I was like, what did the chair look like? Because I'm imagining like this demonic looking chair. And she's like, oh, it looks like something from Goodwill. So like... So I tried to draw like these little connections from essay to essay. So if you notice, if like you're reading really carefully, you'll see Tynan, Judge Tynan, appearing in the Night Stalker essay. And then he appears in my cousin's essay. So I'm trying to weave these really subtle threads through these various essays so that they'll cohere and hold together.
It's you did such a beautiful job. I'm blown away. Okay. So let's talk about men, and let's talk about the truth and storytelling. So okay. We've already sort of touched a little bit upon what happens, some of the dangers when you are not telling your own story, when we are not in charge of our story. So in Mitote, you write, abuelito, I don't hate you, not at all. I'm writing this because I love you. This is a different kind of love letter. It's a tribute to who you really are, not who you would have us believe you were. It's a tribute to truth. We can't honor you without knowing you. So Mitote, for me, felt like an invitation to question what happens when we choose to genuinely see the men in our lives for who they really are, not necessarily as they wish to be remembered. Uh-huh. Can you tell us a little bit more about what prompted you to write this essay and to really examine who your abuelito is and to share with us in a very holistic manner who he is and who he was? And what were you like, what were you hoping that readers would take away from this example?
So I'm fascinated by my grandfather. I've always been fascinated by him as a character.
Because, he's really interesting, by the way.
Yeah, he was a really, really, really like ridiculously colorful man. Like he was a Technicolor man. You know what I mean? Like just like, whoa.
En grande, en vivo.
Exactly. Like teller of tall tales. Like you can't sort truth from fantasy. It just all blends with him. And he in some ways shaped my personality, and he absolutely shaped my appreciation for Mexican literature, especially Mexican Gothic literature. And while I have to credit him for having cultivated that, my grandfather was also a smoldering misogynist. Like not just a misogyny, like a misogynist on fire. Like he was on fire with it.
Y'all, not and, vanilla. There was nothing vanilla about
no.
this.
And he did not believe that women were capable of any sort of artistic greatness because he believed that vice was what created genius and women were too modest and good and generous to live the sorts of lives necessary to become good
artists. Great work.
Exactly. And so, and then to add to that, my grandfather also was thirsty for fame and notoriety. And so in a sense, mi tote is my answer to his wish. So he wanted to be known. So I'm giving him that, but I'm doing it my way. So yes. He's going to be known, but it's because of the work of a granddaughter, not a grandson. So in a way, it's a practical joke that I'm playing on him, but it's a loving practical joke.
I love that. I can't like, what, honestly, what do you think he's, what, if he could sort of opine on this situation, what do you think he would say?
My grandfather would carry in his pocket mimeographed copies of essays that he had written to hand them out to people. So I think that he would carry a copy of this essay and he would approach people and be like, "Is this un ensayo que se trata de mí?" Like, you know what I mean? Like,
I love seeing that vision in my mind. Right? I feel like the way that you describe your grandfather in this in Mitote, I feel like he would say, "Any press is good press." You know, I feel like that would be his style. He'd be like, "Pues por pues siquiera escribió de mí. Estoy en el libro. Este es leíste ese libro, creep." Like, I feel like that's what he would do.
totally.
but it's so beautiful because you really take to task, like you really examine who and question what does it look like to really look at the men in our lives holistically.
Absolutely.
Because so many of us, and I think it's cultural, I think it's gendered, I think it's, you know, a number of factors that contribute to this, but so many of us, I think, walk through the world without really questioning or, you know, being honest about the behaviors of some of the men in our lives, especially when they're elders.
Absolutely. And I think that there is such a thing as posthumous accountability. Because I think that, I mean, what is purgatory but posthumous accountability, right? And I was raised as a Catholic.
So, I love that. I never thought of it that way.
Right? And so as I worked on Mitote, I was in conversation with my grandfather's spirit. I have a lot of altars in my home and I have an ancestor altar. Like you can actually maybe see it. It's right there. right there.
Yes.
So I spent a lot of time at the altar talking to him and basically inviting him to work on the essay with me. He participated, and this is how. So I developed a method for talking to his spirit, and it was this. So he had published an essay in Excelsior, the Mexico City newspaper, that was about Juan Rulfo. And what I did was I copied the essay, I photocopied it, and then I cut it into strips, right? And then what I did was I would ask my grandfather a question. Then I would drop all the strips from the balcony and then pick them up. And then whatever order they came in was my grandfather's answer.
What?
And so I would use that as my guide to structure the essay. So I had a conversation with his spirit. So his spirit helped me to write it in that way. Yeah.
Myriam, I love that. So can we just... I want to take us on a different tangent now. I want to talk about the beauty. I mean, so when I hear this, so I've never heard something like this before. So when I hear that this particular story about how his spirit, your grandfather, really helped to, in some ways, co-write this essay, I cannot help but to think how important that little snippet of your experience that you shared with us about your writing process is so important, because so many writers, particularly when you are a non-white, non-male writer, we are fed this idea that writing has to look a certain way. And I think that just listening to you talk about the way in which you were inspired and the way in which you sort of channeled and were able to move through this essay is so beautiful. It's so important and so rarely talked about in circles. So amigas, if you are a writer and you are in the chat today, can you just let us know if you feel connected to this? Because I think what it drives home to me is your work and your practice is yours, and it can look however you want it to look, however you need it to look. And it's okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's okay to incorporate like whatever method you like. And I wanted to incorporate magic into the process. And so I did that. And it was utterly necessary, because I'm writing about so many spirits that are not incarnate anymore. And so I wanted a way to be able to communicate with them. So I developed these various modalities. So I drew from various magical traditions and used them in order to write essays.
This is so beautiful, Myriam. Thank you so much for sharing this. I'm like, we started with mitote and we ended with magic. I love it. Okay. Let's move on to Navajazo.
Okay.
So you write, some men will shatter the mirror you hold up to them. Next, they will take the shards and stick them in you. This essay really, really reminded me of all of the injustices that battered women endure. Can you tell us a little bit more about why we should listen to and venerate women like Lorena Leonor Gallo?
Absolutely. So that essay is inspired by my adolescent fascination with Lorena Gallo. She became more popularly known as Lorena Bobbitt. She divorced and reverted to her maiden name. And I was fascinated by her as an adolescent when her story was popularized by the tabloids, not only because of the violence that she used in self-defense. She was a battered woman. She used violence to defend herself one evening after her husband sexually assaulted her. The other aspect of Lorena's story that was very compelling for me was that she was an immigrant like my mother. And mm-hmm. She looked a bit like my mother. And I was unused to seeing women who looked, but more importantly, sounded like my mother on television. And so here's this woman who is sort of like the focal point of international media. She looks like my mom. She sounds like my mom. And she's being vilified for having protected herself against a man. And I remember being so dumbfounded by men's responses to her behavior, because her behavior seemed perfectly reasonable to me. If somebody rapes you, you should fight back. And if the weapon that they're using to harm you is their penis, well, remove their weapon then. You know what I mean? Like,
logic.
It seems reasonable to me.
Pretty simple.
So I invoke her as a folk saint, and I compare her, or I contrast her with another folk saint that is the patroness of battered women, who is Rita of Cascia. She's an Italian saint. And what I argue is, it's well and good for the Catholic Church and for those of us who practice folk Catholicism. I consider myself to be a practitioner of folk Catholicism, to have somebody to whom we can appeal to as a shield, right? Because shielding ourselves from malevolent men is important. But a shield isn't enough. We also need a sword, right? So I'm invoking Lorena as the sword. So it's an invitation to sort of honor her as a folk saint, and to sort of draw power from her story and to draw power from her actions. And I also chose her because in the United States, women are overwhelmingly criminalized for defending ourselves from perpetrators of gender-based violence, especially domestic violence perpetrators and sexual assault perpetrators. And Lorena Gallo, interestingly, was not criminalized. She was confined to a hospital and then released from the hospital. And so, unlike many women, she was not convicted of a felony and forced to serve time as a result of what she did in self-defense. And that's what I want for every woman. I want for every woman to be able to walk away freely and to not be punished for what we need to do to survive. And so that's yet another reason why I chose her specifically.
So beautiful. It was, you know, I grew up at a time where I think we're probably around the same era of the same times. And I, you know, it was all over the media. It was such, it was in the popular culture in a way. And I actually knew very little about her until I read your essay. And it really sort of it blew my mind, the way in which you sort of position her as somebody that we should be, you know, really sort of looking to, and that one can sort of take inspiration from, and that in and of itself is such a narrative shift, because for so long media, popular culture really mocked her and you know, just like reduced her, and actually almost like erased
punchline. And like the irony of that is a battered woman becoming a punchline. And yet again, that shows us the intersection of horror and humor in a way that punches down. You know what I mean?
100%. 100%. Okay, so let's talk about, I have so many more questions, and we're running out of time, and I want other people to ask you questions. Let's quickly jump into Waterloo. So in Waterloo, you share with us, this is your first grown-up relationship with Sam, and what it's like to visit her family in the Midwest. And you are about to make some in an attempt to like fit in and be loving and all that jazz, you're trying to make some yummy sopa de arroz, and it's your family's recipe, originally calls for chicken's feet. And you, being so thoughtful and loving, were kind of like, you write, I turn the page. Oh, oops, wait, I don't want to go there yet. You skip the feet, right? So you don't add the chicken feet to the recipe. So in the essay, you write, I turned the page, looked up, and felt regret. I wished I'd embellished the sopa de arroz with chicken feet. I should have never hidden our claws. Tell us a little bit more, please, about this story.
Yeah.
And how you were hiding your claws and why we shouldn't do that.
So that was my editor's favorite story. She loves that story.
Oh, good.
It's about,
I couldn't help but wonder, what's the price that we pay when we hide our claws to appease our lovers or and or their families?
Yeah. So Sam is the name that I give to the person who was my first serious girlfriend, right? And Sam was from the Midwest, born in the Dakotas and then raised in Iowa. And I traveled to Iowa when I was in my early 20s, when I was 21 years old, to meet my then girlfriend's family. And it was such an exotic adventure for me because I had only been to Mexico. So I was like, I'm going to the Midwest. This is so exotic. Like, there are going to be all these Scandinavians and corn, like, you know,
like so, land for miles. Exactly.
So when I arrived, I was given a taste of what's referred to as Midwestern nice or Iowa nice, which is this very superficial niceness that to me had a hollowness to it. And the hollowness provoked anxiety because I wondered like why I was being given this sort of very artificial kind of treacly sweetness, because I knew that it was inauthentic. And then slowly I began to realize that Sam's family was racist and that was why there was this stiffness, around me, and that there was this, that there were all these racialized assumptions about me. There were racialized assumptions about me as a Mexican American person. And there were also racialized assumptions about me as an indigenous descendant. And so, at that time, I very much wanted to, ingratiate myself into this racist family. I wanted them to like me. I was 21, you know, and this is my first girlfriend.
You were in love.
And I was in, yeah, exactly. And so I thought to myself, you know what I can do? I can seduce these people with food. I will seduce these people with food. My family makes amazing chilaquiles. We have this amazing recipe that's from Sayula. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to make my chiles rellenos. That's it. Chiles rellenos sayultecos. And they're going to fall in love with me. And this is going to be incredible. So I cooked for the family and they enjoyed the food. And I thought that I had won them over. I thought that it was a triumph. But then shortly thereafter, I witnessed and experienced more racism. And I was so frustrated because in the talk with my parents about what to cook, because we had even strategized the meal over the phone, we had talked about the sopa de arroz. Yeah. And we had talked about how Felipa, my great grandma, didn't consider sopa de arroz unless it had chicken feet on it. And the chicken feet were supposed to be crisscrossed like this, right? And so I was like, oh, I'm not going to put the chicken feet on because they're going to think we're, you know, primitive for eating feet. You know what I mean? And her favorite thing in the world was to suck the marrow out of the foot. Like,
yeah, lo bueno. It's the good
exactly. Thing. Like that was her jam, was just sit there and suck a chicken foot, you know? And so like, I was like, no, I gotta tone it down for these people. And then once they went all racist again, I was like, mm-mm, I should have given them all the claws.
Yes, because it's about, you know, and a lot of it is sort of age and being in love and really trying to, I think for me, my takeaway was the way in which we contort our stories, our bodies, our, you know, our spirits to appease lovers is not, it's not great. And really it's like, what does it take for us to show up in our fullness and who we really are?
Absolutely. And there's this moment in the essay where there is a nephew, a really, really young nephew who's about 6 or 7 years old, from Iowa, who is attempting a gesture of kindness with me. He had overheard me talking about how much or how fascinated I am by lightning bugs, because we don't have lightning bugs in California and I had never seen them. So he had heard me talking to his grandmother about that. And he had gone and he had captured in his little hands as many lightning bugs as he could. And then he put them in the dresser of the room where I was staying. And the intention was that I would open the drawer and out would fly all these lightning bugs and there would be like this glow in my room. But instead what happened is I opened the drawer and there were all these dead bugs on my clothes.
You're like, what happened?
But it was the sweetest thing. And I kind of feel like that was his chicken feet. You know what I mean? Like, you know?
And so appropriate that it was a child to show you his true self. Right?
Exactly. And I wanted to include him in that story because I didn't want it to be a hopeless story. I didn't want it to be a story of this racist, hopeless, lost, nihilistic group of people. I wanted to show how like this 7-year-old had yet to be infected by these ideologies and could have this woman in his home who he knew was different, but that he developed affection for, you know?
Right. He could still develop a connection with them because he was open. He was hearing you. He was actually seeing you for who you were and you were seeing him.
At one point he decided that we were going to write a book together. He wanted it to have his name and he was going to be a wolf. And I was going to narrate him as a wolf going on his adventures. So we became friends.
Oh, I love that. Thank you for sharing, Myriam. Okay, so we've got about 6 minutes left before we wrap. You guys, this is a great time. If you've been thinking about a question, please drop it in the chat. In the meantime, while we are going through questions, Myriam, let me ask you... So I'm going to sort of go towards the end of my questions because we're almost at time. But for me, one of the biggest takeaways from your book is the reminder that if we don't share, if we don't write our story, someone else will. And odds are that other person probably isn't as well qualified as you are to tell your own story and may even get paid 7 figures to tell that story. Specifically in Pendeja, You Ain't Steinbach, you write, while we're forced to contend with imposter syndrome, dilettantes who grab material, style, and even voice are lauded for and rewarded. Can you tell us a little bit more about this piece?
Absolutely. So some years ago, I was asked by Ms. Magazine to review a fiction title, American Dirt. I knew nothing about the author. I knew nothing about the title, and received the book. And I was really like perplexed by the book. I actually thought it was maybe a book about agronomy or agriculture because dirt was in the title. So I was like, but then I had a blurb from Stephen King and I was like, why is Stephen King blurbing a book about dirt? Like, this is weird.
Something doesn't quite connect.
Right? I was like, this is weird. So then I read the first chapter and I was like, what the fuck is this? Because it's like, it's basically a narco novela translated for a gringo audience, right? Like, that's what it is. And so I was like disgusted and horrified by it. I drafted my review and then the review was rejected and I was told that it could be published on the condition that I revise my review and praise the book. And I said, I can't, I have no praise to offer. And my job is as a critic. I don't have anything flattering to say. There's nothing praiseworthy about it. So they killed the review and I was really, really bothered. So I self-published the review and then I started to receive like more and more information about American Dirt. And I was given a heads up that it was an Oprah Book Club choice before the announcement was made. And at that point, I realized how pernicious the release of the book was going to be, given the rhetoric around Mexico at the time. Because if you'll recall, Trump was president.
Right.
And Trump was spitballing invading Mexico, right? And
spreading horrible, horrible lies about our community
that were upheld by this book that was going to be read by millions. And so I wrote an essay critical of the publishing industry's white supremacy, and embedded the review of the book in it. And it went viral. And I was accused of destroying opportunities for white male writers, which is just, it's funny. I just have to laugh. Like,
you're like, oh, wait, let me get my tissue. Hold on.
Exactly. I'm like, what? So.
Yeah, it's such a great essay. And I feel like one of the biggest takeaways for me is you have a story. And if you're not going to tell it, someone else will.
So definitely.
Tell your story. Myriam, thank you so much for spending some time with us. So we're almost at time, but we have a question. I'd love for, if we can have hopefully them unmute and ask them, is that okay? Okay.
Oh, totally.
So Francesca Guerrero, if you're still here and you'd like to ask your question, please unmute. Otherwise I can ask it for you. Let's see. Francesca. Okay. I don't see her. Okay. I'm just going to ask the question for you. Do you consider yourself an activist for women?
Yes, 100%. And I engage in different forms of activism. I'm going to be going through, hopefully, a training in about a month for sexual assault counseling.
Mm.
So yes, I embrace that label.
And I feel like any reader who picks up Creep will not only understand the kind of work that you're committed to doing, because I feel like you're an activist on so many different levels. You're an activist for storytelling. You're an activist for women. You're an activist for, you know, so many different facets of our humanity. And I think it's really important for those of you who pick up Creep and who read it to like understand that if you're reading some of Myriam's work, there is also a tremendous amount of beauty and levity and history embedded in your work. And so I just want to thank you, Myriam, for sharing your story. It's really just so incredible. So we are now a little over time. We're at 5:01. I didn't get to ask you a couple of questions, and I really want to acknowledge in front of you and to the amigas that if you get this book, please read it. And Creep is going to blow you away. I know that we briefly talked about it in the beginning. And because of its beauty, its power, and its intensity, I feel like I can't ask you this question because it would require a significant amount of time for us to really give it justice, give the essay, the subject matter, your story and what you say. But I'd like to say that Creep has been one of the most powerful essays I've read all year. And I want to thank you for writing it. And I want to thank you for sharing with us the way that art can become a protective cocoon.
Thank you.
So Myriam, we're 5:02. Thank you for this incredible conversation. Your words are incredibly, incredibly memorable and gorgeous. I'd like to take a minute to thank Avid Reader Press, and Simon Schuster again for sponsoring this event. Miriam, thank you for spending time with us. I loved Creep. Everyone who I've talked to that has read Creep has also really loved it. We would love to see it in schools. So let's get it on some, you know, some class, like this is like required class reading. I'd like to say thank you to Gabby for helping us behind the scenes and making this conversation happen. And I'd like to thank our amazing amigas for showing up and making Miriam feel so welcome in the community. These monthly chats are always a treat, and it's so insightful to be in conversation with, you know, with the amigas and also with the author. Thank you so much. If you'd like to purchase Creep, which I highly, highly recommend, get it for yourself, get it for a friend, get it for your comadre. there are some links in the chat where you can get it from the Fabian Frodes bookshop and support us and support my work. Buenas noches. Thank you so much again, Miriam, for being here, for the courage to write this, because this is revolutionary. This is so special.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And thank you for your kindness and for your hospitality.
My goodness. Of course. I loved having multiple conversations with you this year. I'm so excited. And I can't wait to read what's next. Okay. Welcome back. We look forward to kicking off year 3 of Latinas en Libros in January. I hope everybody has an amazing holiday season and have a great time reading Creep this winter. See you again soon.
Bye, everybody.